All right, in my previous video on Broadway in the 1960s, I talked about some of the major achievements of the musical on Broadway in the 1960s. And I strongly urge you to check out the videos on the website for the course with examples of musicals. So that you get some idea of the diversity and scope of musical production, at least in these examples of it that are available through the website and YouTube. Let me discuss then Broadway in the 1970s and after as a result of these turbulent events of the 1960s. The 1970s was not a happy time for Broadway, and people began talking about the end of Broadway and what could be done to save Broadway. As many theaters closed, so many shows were failing, and hard times with the recession of the 1970s. Exacerbated the difficulty of identifying audiences to support the Broadway theater, the transformation of the economy through people moving to away from cities to suburbs and businesses moving away and so forth, so that the inner cities became encumbered by all kinds of economic difficulties. And as I say, it looked like Broadway might even disappear. At any rate, in the 1970s, theater saw a decline in large cast productions. Broadway was famous in the decades preceding the 1970s for these big shows. Lots of people on the stage, big production values, big dance numbers, and plays, not necessarily musicals, that had little communities of characters interacting with each other. But after the 1970s, the theater in Broadway, and then subsequently throughout the United States, witnesses a serious decline in large cast productions. Plays became much serious plays certainly, became much smaller in the number of characters, the number of scenes, the production values. Many theaters closed because they could not develop economies of scale. These are not feasible theater. While other media could adopt economies of scale, the theater remained increasingly expensive to produce because it could not reproduce its work in a way that, say, movies or music could. If you spend millions of dollars on a movie, you can distribute that movie to thousands of theaters and reach millions of viewers off of that initial investment, which produces further results when you sell the movie to television or syndicate it or put it on DVDs. That's economies of scale. You're able to reproduce a fundamental product, which may have a high investment, and reduce the cost of consumers to obtain that product. Because it's distributed so broadly and so intensely. Theater cannot do that. If you want a bigger show and require musicians and dancers as well as actors to perform in it, it costs the same to produce it no matter where you do it. It's more, of course, more expensive in Broadway, but than it would be at theaters in other cities. But it's extremely difficult for theater to do anything about controlling cost other than to get to do smaller productions. Taking shows on the road after they've been successful on Broadway does not really help the theater to become more profitable or successful unless the show has achieved such astounding success that audiences are ready for it in cities around the nation. And that takes a long time for that to happen once you've set up a Broadway show. So if you invest $1 million in a Broadway show, it generally costs $1 million to a week to sustain that show. And that means a lot of customers, and those customers have to pay very high prices to sustain the show from week to week. And if they're paying those very high prices, they're going to expect some kind of powerful, if not transformative, experience that is dependent on high production values and very expensive talent. So it was a vicious cycle for Broadway in the 70s, and it took a long time for the Broadway culture to figure out how to respond to the crisis. At the same time, you had the rise of the public theater. Joseph Papp deserves mention insofar as he understood that Broadway was in a state of crisis and indeed decline, but that the public needed some access to theater that was much more accessible than that which Broadway was providing. So he developed a relationship with the city of New York to establish the public theater in which the city invested in things like Shakespeare in the Park and the establishment of an off-Broadway theater down on 14th Street in Manhattan, which allowed for all kinds of cool and innovative productions to take place. So I'm pointing this out because in the 70s, there was a general recognition that some other way of financing and producing theater had to emerge in response to this problem of economies of scale and the decline in investment in theater, that the crisis that I've spoken about that gripped the theater in the 1970s. In the 1970s and after, musicals dominated Broadway almost to the exclusion of non-musical theater. Producing musicals entailed extreme high risk, and with shows like Starlight Express in 1984, you had this huge investment in elaborate technologies for performance with dancers on roller skates and on ramps that encircled the audience or went through the audience, and spectacular lighting effects, and the introduction of film and video into shows in order to impress audiences. Perhaps the most recent example of this extreme high risk involved in producing musicals is the production on Broadway this year of Spider-Man. Julie Taymor was the director of it. The most expensive show ever produced, involving incredible stunts and enormous production values and some of the most complicated technology ever employed in a Broadway production. Taymor lost her job directing the show, and all kinds of controversies erupted over the production of this show because the risk was so high and the results were so disappointing. So it was an example of the most recent example of the extreme high risk involved in producing anything for Broadway, and the intense level of competition required to attract audiences and to attract talent into the Broadway theater. In the 70s, Andrew Lloyd Webber, having achieved success with Jesus Christ Superstar back in 1970, went on to shape the musical in a new dimension with Evita in 1976, a show set in Argentina about the wife of the Argentine dictator Juan Perón. Evita kind of celebrated her glamorous career. She was a movie star.
Who became
a seductive political force in Argentina in the 1950s. But in this show, you had basically no interaction between characters, but one set of scenes after another that dramatized episodes in the life of Evita, rather than forthrightly told her story. It was like a sequence of musical tableau to describe her origins, career, and death. Weber went on in subsequent musicals to build the musical more like an opera and create these large-scale arias for the musical, replacing the conventional song. He expanded the orchestra, developed a more symphonic sound for the musical, and escalated the production value so that audiences for the musical saw in his work an opportunity to move to a higher level of experience of the musical associated with opera, but perhaps not quite so demanding as opera in terms of the knowledge or experience required to appreciate it. Cats in 1981 featured all animals as the characters in a show about unity of cats in London, and developed the tunes and personalized, differentiated each of the cats in a way that made them seem very human. And then in Phantom of the Opera, he reached, you might say, his pinnacle of success in terms of innovation in the musical by treating the Phantom of the Opera as a story deserving of some kind of operatic treatment, a very large-scale production. But these works went to Broadway only after they had been seriously tested in London, or well before they got to Broadway. This is typical for Broadway shows. They have a preview or test performances in cities before they reach Broadway. But the great, powerful successes Andrew Lloyd Webber and indeed others who followed him or were contemporary with him developed their shows elsewhere rather than in New York City. There's another feature of Broadway in the 1970s. And subsequently, revivals. Broadway began to resurrect its past hits. It began to focus on star names and star writers, like David Mamet, whom we'll talk about a little later, or putting on shows that had achieved success in the earlier decades or in the 1950s, but bringing them back with big stars. Waiting for Godot, that's a famous example. Streetcar Named Desire, it was a big hit with Marlon Brando back in the early 1947. But that show gets revived every once in a while by stars from Hollywood wanting to come out and be on Broadway and do the show. But you need that kind of star power from Hollywood to secure an audience for Broadway shows. After 1970s, there's emphasis on escalating production values to attract affluent audiences, so Broadway became geared toward wealthier patrons, whereas in earlier decades, they paid much more attention to sort of people in New York City coming to shows. That changed in the 70s. The audience for most Broadway shows is from out of town, they're in New York, they want to spend money, and they have money. And they want to take that show's experience with them back to whatever town they come from. So that was different. Audiences for shows on Broadway, much more affluent in the 70s and up till this day, previous decades. The skill in crafting dialogue diminished from the 1970s. You had many more plays which featured monologue or characters speaking in isolation, not interacting with others. They stand in the spotlight, say what they have to say, and then the spotlight goes out and comes up on somebody else. But there's less skill in developing dialogue from the 70s onwards. I mentioned Chorus Line from 1976, famous production from Michael Bennett. The whole story is about these nine people on Broadway and about their determination and struggle to find a place in the chorus line. But they don't really interact with each other. They dance with each other in the chorus line. But each person comes out, sells their story, and steps back into the chorus line. And Endozaki Shange in 1975 achieved great success with her play For Colored Girls Who Have Considered Suicide. And here she presented a group of black women describing their diverse experiences, finding their place in the world in which they find themselves, but they all speak alone and separate from each other. Even if they all appear on the stage and seem to be related to each other by being there, they are essentially alone. And that's been a feature of many, many plays since the 70s, this focus on those who speak alone on stage, and it connected to the development of acting talent, which I'll talk about in later videos. And I do strongly, once again, recommend that you see the videos related to these themes that are posted through the website for Chorus Line, Entozaki Shange, and Andrew Lloyd Webber. Finally, Broadway is always synonymous with the commercial potential and highest market value of theater in the United States. With Broadway, we're looking at how theater achieves value and power in relation to a market, to its ability to generate money for those who produce the shows in the Broadway theaters and beyond. And it remains that. It is the measure of commercial value for theater in the United States. But it should be pointed out that Broadway survived the 1970s only in the end through heavy urban investment from New York City. In terms of public infrastructure to support the performing arts, the city government made some decisions in the 70s that they didn't want to lose Broadway. So they spent, once they got out of their financial mess, and it was really serious back then, once they got out of that mess, they did put in a lot of money into the development of a public infrastructure for sustaining the theater culture, not only of Broadway, but off-Broadway and beyond, the other performing arts as well. They derived a lot of revenue from the hotel tax and building up the appeal of New York City as a tourist attraction. But one must remember that Broadway survived not entirely because it came up with these powerful, successful shows that I've described that revived faith in the Broadway institution to produce memorable and important shows. It survived because the city and the public in New York put money into apartment buildings, into urban redevelopment, and into programs that allowed Broadway to take advantage of talent that was not otherwise available. I want to talk a little bit about theater as it was supported in other countries in my next video.